You have your Bible, say amen.
Amen.
If you don't have your Bible, say amen. No, don't do it. Just kidding. If you have your iPhone and your Bible's on there, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. See, that's important. Just want to make sure you have those things available with you wherever you are. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Romans chapter 6 this morning. Romans chapter 6, verses 12, 13, 14. Today we're going to kind of pick up where we left off from last week. We didn't get finished. We talked about shedding pounds. I know every year it seems like around the first, I really come to a place in my life where I decide this year is going to be the year where I do better than I've ever done before. This is going to be the year where I really stick to my schedule, where I stick to my diet, where I stick to the weights and the treadmill. All of those things I think are going to help me shed a few pounds. I commit to, the problem is I only commit to them partially. You ever done that? If you're guilty of partial commitment, say, oh me.
Oh me.
Oh me. And so that's what I do every single year, and I think about what really shedding what looks like, or shedding pounds looks like. And as we talked about last week, we really came to the conclusion that the most important thing that you can shed that is holding you back, that is causing extra weight in your life, extra pounds in your life, spiritually speaking, is sin. Sin really grabs a hold of us, and it keeps us from moving forward in a right relationship with God. And Satan, when he has that kind of control in our lives, when sin has that kind of control in our lives, then we have not given ourselves to God for him to be in control. Really, what we talked about last week, and so a couple of things I'll share with you quickly. If you have your bulletins, you can turn those over and you'll see that the outline is there. We went on and filled in last week's part for you, but take control of yourself. And this is what the scripture says, just about you being controlled. It says, therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies, and you should obey it in its lusts. And so you've got to take control. Don't let sin control you. If we were to be honest, we're guilty. Many of us, most of us, are guilty of allowing sin to dictate the steps we take, the choices we make in life. And the reason is because of the control it has over our lives. We struggle with sin. Harmatia is that Greek word that I shared with you last week. And I want you to understand that you have a choice. As a believer, you have a choice to make on whether or not you give control to sin or you give surrender to God. It is completely up to you. But the big idea is for you as a child of God is you must be in pursuit of Jesus. If you're going to surrender, then you must be in pursuit of Jesus. It's important, isn't it? Isn't it important for you to be in pursuit of Jesus as a Christ follower? You know, when Jesus was going after the disciples, what they did is they laid down everything they had and followed him immediately. They began to be in pursuit of Jesus. That's what I desire my relationship with my Savior to look like. I want to be in pursuit of him. He has already pursued me. He pursued me all the way to the cross. Amen? He pursued you all the way to the cross. Once we acknowledge our sin and trust Jesus to be Lord of our lives, we finally come into a place where it is up to us now to pursue him. He never stops pursuing you. Understand that. But he now desires that you would pursue him. So how do we pursue him? How do I avoid giving control to sin in my life? Well, I've got to study the word faithfully. We know that. Every day we have an opportunity at some point along the day. I want to give this time, this scheduled moment, even if it isn't scheduled, I've decided that I'm going to give this time to my Lord in the studying of his word. Prayer is another area that we must surrender our life, surrender our thoughts, surrender our heart to, right? It's communicating with the Creator. I believe more than anything else that in any relationship you'll ever find yourself in, if you do not communicate, it will not work. Oh me. Amen or oh me? Is that not true? You've got to communicate. And the same works in relationship to our Creator. We must be in communication with Him. I'm telling you this because He already communicates with us. You say, well, preacher, I've never heard Him speak a word to me. Have you picked up the Bible? This is His love gift to you. He loves you through Jesus, but He left His words for you. Now, listen to me. God may use an individual to come and to pour something into your life. But the most important way you will ever learn about the things of heaven is to study the one who created it. And that is found in the written word of God. I believe, just as Paul told Timothy, it is living and breathing and sharper than any double-edged sword. I believe that about the word of God. How many of you believe that about Scripture? Amen. And so it's so important for us. So take control of yourselves. Don't let sin reign in your heart. And then don't use your body for unrighteousness. We talked about that a little bit last week. And hoplon is the Greek word for instrument. But really in the Greek, it carries more of a meaning of weapon. Don't allow your body to be used as a weapon for unrighteousness. You're telling me that my body can be used as a weapon, as a tool for unrighteousness? Absolutely, your body can be used as a weapon or as a tool. And a weapon is used to destroy things or build things up. Which? What's a weapon used for? Typically for the destruction of things, is it not? And so my desire, I think God's desire, as we break the word down, He desires for you to surrender yourself to Him in such a way that He has total control. And as we pick up where we left off last week, I want you to see really the second thing, and this will be found in the second half of verse 13 and verse 14. You need to see this, because last week we really talked about the negative side of what sin looks like and how you are not to give control to sin. You are to maintain control in the spiritual. You are to give God control. But you have a choice in the matter. So let's look at the rest of this. Let me go and encourage you this morning to honor God by standing at the reading of His Word. 12, 13, and 14. We're going to read them all, and then we're going to conclude our sermon this morning from last week. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies, that you should obey it in its lusts. And do not present your members as instruments or weapons of unrighteousness to sin. But here's that door that has a hinge that swings both ways, right? I need you to get this. This is God's desire for you, is to get His word. Listen, but present yourself to God as alive from the dead. So important. We're going to talk about that this morning. And your members as instruments or weapons for righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. So let me encourage you to pray with me, and then we'll get started. Father, we thank You as we look at Your Word, Lord, that You do speak to us. And Father, for us really to get in that mode of understanding that You desire to communicate with us as we study Your Word, if we won't just briskly read through, but that we pay attention to what we're reading, You will most certainly speak to our hearts. Our greatest desire, one of our greatest desires as Christ followers, as the saved, as those who believe that Jesus died and rose from the grave on the third day, those who believe that He sits at the right hand of the Father in heaven right now, Lord, we know that You desire to communicate and speak to our hearts. Lord, I pray that You would allow us to be found faithful as we study Your Word, as we pray and communicate to You, that we would listen as You desire to communicate to us. Father, this morning, as we continue in this section of Scripture, I pray in advance that You would begin to tear down strongholds that are in the lives of between husband and wives. Father, that You would tear that sin barrier down that has kept us from that right relationship with You. Lord, that today we would move forward in that pursuit of Jesus and knowing and learning more about the desires, the purpose you have created us for specifically as individuals. Father, today we give you all praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And so we're just going to get started. Listen to me. The first thing that I want to share with you this morning, again, turn over on the back of your bulletin, is you got to give yourself wholeheartedly to God. You got to give yourself wholeheartedly to God. We're so guilty of giving God just a little bit of ourselves. Just a little bit. Just a little bit. I don't want to surrender everything, because if I surrender everything, then I'll have no control myself. If I surrender everything to God, so there's this conflict, there's this struggle, this war that rages in your mortal bodies. This body that before Christ is dead in trespasses and sin. Matter of fact, look at Romans chapter 6, verse 5. We're going to read probably all the way through 8, maybe 9. Listen to this. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, listen, pay close attention. If we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. So, before Christ, we're dead in our trespasses and sin. After Christ, we are now raised from the dead. That's a great picture of the sacrifice Jesus made for us. And you remembering that he did not remain in that tomb when they took him down off of the cross. Friends, I tell you this because I believe that we forget there's power in the resurrection of Jesus. There's so much power in the resurrection, and we forget because as believers, we live as though there's no power in the name of Jesus. And that alone is an issue because as a Christ follower, I know my Redeemer lives. As a Christ follower, do you, right now in your relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, do you believe that you serve a living God? Or is he someone who hung on a cross and was buried in a borrowed tomb? And that's it. Do you think that he's still in Jerusalem somewhere in a borrowed tomb? He's not. He busted the gates of hell wide open so that your sin would be forgiven. And that's the reason you and I now, according to the scripture, if we are in the likeness of his death, certainly, he says, that's with power. You can know beyond a shadow of a doubt that certainly we will be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, the old person, the old me. He died to the old nature. Now, you don't forget this. He's still very much present. But you have to surrender your life to the new man every single day. You have to forget the old man every single day. So let's continue with this section of Scripture. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. For he who died has been freed from sin. Just pay attention to what you're studying, when you're studying it. Listen to the words. You are now free from sin. How is it possible that you can be freed from sin? Are you ready for this? Because Jesus is alive. He's not dead. He is very much alive. This is when we continue. Let me find it. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we die with Christ, we believe that he shall also, or that we shall also, live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. If you are a Christ follower, if you are in pursuit of Jesus, listen to me, death has no say in your life. No more. You are free from sin. You are free from death. hell, and the grave, and you are alive, set free from sin, alive forevermore. Because of the sacrifice made on an old rugged cross over 2,000 years ago. That's powerful. I'm alive today because of Jesus. I'm alive eternally because of Jesus. You're alive today because of Jesus. You're alive eternally because of Jesus. Give yourself wholeheartedly to God. So now, let's chase after the rest of this section of Scripture this morning. Look at verse 13. Alright? The Scripture says, do not present your bodies as instruments of unrighteousness. We talked about that last week. Or as a weapon of unrighteousness. If your eyes cause you to sin, pluck them out, is what the Scripture says. It's better to go through life without an eye than it is to be thrown eternally with your eyes into the hellfire, is what Scripture says. If your hand causes you to sin, then cut it off. It's better to go through life maimed without a hand than it is to be thrown eternally into hellfire with both of them. So, now you're thinking about that, and you're saying, so you're telling me that I am to cut off my hand, or I am to pluck out my eye? Well, it was symbolism. And the idea is that you've got to completely surrender your life to God. Completely surrender your life. Give yourself wholeheartedly to God, not just part of you. And so, you have to come to a point in your life where, A, under number two, is you are living like you've been raised from the dead. You've got to do that. As a believer, as a Christ follower, if you're no longer dead in your trespasses and sin, then you must live as though you are alive to Christ. You must live as though He has completely changed your life. So listen, right here it says, but present yourself to God as being alive from the dead. Present yourself to God. This word present literally means to cause something to be. To cause something to be. You don't cause your bodies to be used for righteousness. This is what he tells us right here in verse 12 and in the first part of 13. Do not present, do not cause your body to be used as weapons of unrighteousness. So this word present means cause something to be. However, he says there's that three-letter word, but. Circle that in your Bibles if you have something to circle with. You need to remember that because it completely changes direction. If you're going in a negative direction and then there's a but, something good is coming. If you're going in a positive direction and there's a but, something negative is coming. Next. So circle that and understand we just finished with the negative context. Now we're moving into the positive context, and he says, present yourself to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments or weapons or tools of righteousness to God. Your desire as a believer should be to present yourself to God, to call something to be. So the Scripture tells us in Romans chapter 12, verse 22. How many of you know Romans chapter 12, verse 22? I beseech you therefore, brethren, or I urge you therefore, brethren, I urge you. It was a plea from Paul. He was literally pleading with the believers in Rome. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present, there it is again, your bodies as a living sacrifice. Holy and well-pleasing to God is what the Scripture says. Holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Not too much to ask. So look at verse 2. And do not be conformed to this world. I want to say that again. And do not be conformed to this world. But what? Be transformed. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So Paul was urging the church at Rome. He was urging them. Literally what he was doing is he was calling them into action. He was calling them to make a decision for the positive. He was calling them to do something that they had failed to do in the past. He was calling them to stop living for themselves in this world and to begin living for Jesus, for His honor and His glory, that His name would forever be honored and glorified in, as an individual, right? We talk about that. So if I were to come out there and I were to choose, just come up to any single one of you as an individual and I would tell you that God desires that your life would be about bringing glory to Him, would I be wrong? No. God's desire for you is that your life be about bringing glory to God. So now you've got to ask yourself the question, is your life well-pleasing to God? I can't answer that for you. That's between you and the Holy Spirit. But I can tell you, if you ask God that question and you listen, He will either convict you, your heartbeat will about explode out of your chest because sin is reigning and God is convicting you, or you will have confidence in the power of God through Jesus Christ because you know that you know that you know that you are living your life in such a way that Jesus is going to get the glory. So, how are you living your life? Answer that question for yourself. You've got to wholeheartedly give yourself to God. Wholeheartedly. With everything that you have. When you go into a marriage relationship, if you just kind of partially give yourself to your spouse, you're going to have problems in a major way. You can't just partially do it. You've got to surrender everything. It's for the well-being of the other so that you can then communicate, so that you can then serve one another, so that you can then love one another, so that you can then grow together with one another. God's desire for you in relationship with Him. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice. Thusia is the word sacrifice. Listen, it means something offered. It's not difficult, is it? Something offered. Now, big picture here, though, is that in the Old Testament, it was a sacrifice requiring death. That's the picture of the Old Testament of a sacrifice. It required the blood of whatever was being sacrificed. You are required now to give yourself as a living sacrifice. God is not requiring death from you. Jesus already paid the penalty of death. He became the living sacrifice unto death for you. Now God desires that you would live for Him. That you know, the hardest thing as a believer is to live for the glory of God. I hear people all the time, you've heard it, say, I'm ready to die and go on and be with my Savior in heaven. But are you ready to live for Jesus? That's really the question, isn't it? As a Christ follower, as a believer, are you willing to live for Him? My prayer is that you are willing to do that. You're willing to make those sacrifices. It says, give your bodies as a living. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice. What does that look like for you? What does that look like in your home? What does that look like in your work? What does that look like in your church to present your bodies a living sacrifice? It means that you are willing to offer up yourself to be used by God. Anyway, God needs to use you. If we're going to honor Him with our lives, if we're going to honor Him with our choices, He wants you to be available. You need to be available. You need to be listening. You need to be prepared to move when you experience the Spirit of God swell up in your heart. And when you're trying to go this direction and you sense the Spirit turning you in this direction, you have to be willing to change course. Because that honors God. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice. All right, here's B. You've got to let God use you. We were kind of talking about that, right? As a weapon for His glory, as a tool for His glory. Let God use you. And so the scripture goes on and says, present your bodies to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. He desires to use you. He wants you to set ablaze on earth and as many people as you come across or able to come in contact with to share the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Listen to me. The gospel is a beautiful story of redemption for all those who will listen and hear and experience life eternal. It is the most beautiful, tragic story ever told. Isn't it? That my King would decide that I was worth saving, was willing to step down out of the glories of heaven. And Philippians said that he didn't even think that it was wrong for him to consider it robbery to be equal with God. But he humbled himself, it says. He humbled himself to the point of death. Even, the scripture says, death of the cross, which in those days was the most hideous way to be tortured and breathe your last. So, God's desire for you. Listen, if I were to come around and talk with you as an individual, or you were to come talk to me, there's not a single person in here who is a Christ follower who would not say, yes, I desire to be used by God. Yes, I desire to honor God with my life. There is not a single one of you in here. And if there is still breath in your lungs, then you have an opportunity, whether it be through witness, testimony, or action, to give Him praise until He calls you home. You have that opportunity still. So listen to what 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3 through 5 says. It says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do, right? This is flesh and bones, flesh and blood. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Not if we're living for Jesus. This is what Paul was saying to the church at Corinth. If we're living for Jesus, then we do not war according to the flesh. Because according to the flesh, I'm going to tell you, I know some of you desired at one point or another to come up here and just smack that old preacher right across the face, right? You ever been in a situation as a child where you and your buddy, you're friends, but y'all are just jawing back and forth to each other, and one of you gets tired of it, and he just pushes the other one as hard as he can push him, and then when the other one gets up off the ground, he runs towards the other one, and he's just swinging with everything, with his head down and everything he's got. You ever done that as a child? Be honest. How many of you have ever done that? Bert, you're not supposed to raise your hand today, buddy. Mr. May, you raise your hand. Tell it over. Right? We've done that. Most all of us have done that at some point in our lives. But God's Word says we don't war according to the flesh anymore. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God. Here it is. For pulling down strongholds. Verse 5. Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Every thought into captivity according to the obedience of Christ. Your thoughts. Are used for righteousness or unrighteousness. Your thoughts are used to build up or tear down. Your thoughts are so important. What are those things that you think about during the day? What are those things that run through your mind? What are those things that cause your gears to turn? What are those things? They're either to glorify God, or they're either not going to glorify God. So what are those things that run around in your mind? What are you thinking about right now? What are you thinking about? Are you thinking about how you're a good old boy? That you're not always thinking good, or you're not always thinking bad sometimes because you're not thinking anything?
Right.
I'm guilty of that often and a lot. Listen, you know, the tragic part of that is there's a whole lot of good old boys going straight to hell when they die. Because Jesus is not Lord of their lives. They've not confessed their sin and trusted Jesus to save them. And I can't, as badly as I desire, cannot make that decision for you. So, if you're going to let God use you as a weapon for His honor and His glory, then what decisions are you to make? How are you to go about being used as a living sacrifice for Jesus. Well, how many of you know the fruits of the Spirit? How many of you know Galatians chapter 5? How many of you know verses 22 and 23? Write it down on your paper. Remember that, because if you're going to be used as a living sacrifice, then there are certain attributes and characteristics that you should live your life by. And you should do that. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And then it says this, against such there is no law. To live your life in such a way, to live with love, to live with joy. Do you know where joy comes from? From God. Joy is heavenly sent. You can be happy on this earth because happiness is a product of your situation. But you cannot experience joy without Jesus. I'm telling you, that is biblical. You cannot experience joy without Jesus. You can be happy for a season, but you can't experience joy without Jesus. Love. What kind of love? The Bible says that even a sinner loves, right? But not agape love, they know. Not the way the Father in heaven loves His creation. And so the fruit of the Spirit is love, godly love, agape love, joy, heavenly joy, peace, peace, peace. This peace literally is that you are not at war with God. That's what this kind of peace is. And if you have this kind of peace, then joy is present in your life as well. You beginning to see the picture? Are you beginning to see a little more clear that you can do a whole lot differently than you have, that I can do a whole lot better than I have? If I would love the way Jesus loves, and I would have joy the way God desires me to have joy in Him, I have joy that I would have peace, heavenly, godly peace, that I would have patience, godly patience, that I would... Listen, this one is what we struggle with so many times, waiting on God. You know why we have to wait so long? Because we are so stubborn and hard-headed that it takes more for God to get us where we need to be. Oh me! It takes more. It takes more hardship. It takes more pain. It takes more suffering because we have not arrived. Long-suffering, patience. I want to wait on God until God calls me home. I want to wait on God until God gives me a job to do. I'm going to wait on God. But while you're waiting on God, do what you already know He's called you to do. Love. So love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is like it. Love who? How are you to love your neighbor? As yourself. So, long-suffering, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. Be faithful to the end. Be faithful until the end. Be faithful until the end. Never give up on God. Never throw Him to the side. He is not going to give up on you. You do not give up on Him. You remember gentleness and self-control. Against such there is no law. You got to let God use you as a weapon for His glory. I know if we would just say, Lord, here I am. Use me how you would choose to use me, that He would do just that. And so the takeaway of today, more than anything else, that I want you to be able to proclaim this. I want you to be able to say this. As a believer, I want you to be able to say, God, I boldly declare Jesus is the Lord of my life. I boldly declare Jesus is the Lord of my life, and that nothing else can rule me. I don't know if I have that on the back of the bulletin or not, but that's the takeaway of the day. That's the takeaway of the day. I boldly declare that Jesus is Lord of my life. Listen to me. If you will boldly declare Jesus is Lord of your life, He rules your life, you have surrendered, you live a surrendered life to Him, then nothing else will be able to rule you. Nothing else will be able to reign. We talked about reigning last week. It means to rule as king. So what is ruling your life today? What do you need to get shed of today? What is causing pain and heartache in your life today? Why do you ask, preacher? You don't have time. Listen to me. You can get shed of it this morning. You can get rid of it. You can move, take the first step today towards a better relationship to Jesus. And if you're here and you've never trusted Jesus to be Lord of your life, then today you can take the first step in living a life that is found alive in Jesus. If you would confess your sin, if you would invite Jesus to be Lord of your life. Listen. Would you be willing to say, I boldly declare Jesus as Lord of my life today? Would you be willing to say that? Lord, have an invitation. Just a moment. Miss Janice, if you would join me, come on up. We struggle so many times to find that safe place in this world. We're always in pursuit of something. We're always chasing after something else. We're always chasing after someone else. We're always moving. Sometimes we get stagnant in our relationship with the Savior. And if that's where you are as a believer, then I want to tell you something. This morning, it's time to change your shoes. It's time for you to put on some that are much more comfortable in the gospel. It's time for you to shod yourself differently than you've ever put on shoes in the past. It's time for you as a believer to prepare yourself to chase after the things of God. And if you'll do that, then you will be one of those that will truly be able to say, I boldly declare Jesus is Lord of my life. And if Jesus is Lord of your life, then nothing else will be able to rule your life. Not sin, not heartache, not pain, not false happiness, not the deception of the devil. None of those things will have control. If you will surrender today everything to Jesus, this morning, what do you have to get shed of? What things in your life are weighing you down from pursuing Jesus with everything that you have? Today, would you make a decision to shed that sin and invite Jesus to be Lord of your life? Christian, today, would you shed that sin that has so easily ensnared us, and today choose to begin pursuing Jesus again today? Let's pray. Father in heaven, this morning there are so many things in this world that captures our attention. And when the things of this world captures our attention, the things of this world, we aren't able to hear you. We aren't even able to see where you're working if the things of this world blind us. I pray, Father, for those who are here today, that you would move upon their hearts this very moment. Lord, as believers, you would move their heart to run towards you once again. Oh, blessed Father, that today would be a day where their life changes forevermore as they pursue you. And they shed those things that hinder their pursuit of you. And Father, for those that are lost, dead in their trespasses and sin, today I pray that they would repent of their sin and call upon the name of Jesus to be Lord of their lives. In Jesus' name. Let me encourage you to do something as they pray. Let me encourage you to stand. And this altar is open. Would you come and would you just shed that weight that is hindering you from moving forward with Jesus? You come today. The altar is open. to thee. I pray that you're able to say that this morning. Jesus, I come to thee. Listen, he came running for you. It's only fit that we would go running in pursuit of him. Amen? God is good?
All the time?
All the time?
God is good.
So glad you're here with us today. Invite a friend back in. We've got two more messages in this New Year series. And I'm praying we may move straight into commandments.